Ora, muito bom dia a todas e a todos. Meu nome é Eduarda Marques, estou aqui como diretora deste Centro de Juventude e da Direção Regional de Lisboa e Vale do Tejo do Instituto Português do Desporto e da Juventude. Queria, antes de tudo, então, cumprimentar quem me acompanha aqui no palco. Alexandra Silva, Presidente da Plataforma Portuguesa para os Direitos das Mulheres. Ana Sofia Fernandes, Vice-Presidente do Lobby Europeu das Mulheres. Rachel Moran, representante fundadora da Space. Senhoras e senhores convidados, cumprimentar-vos e dar-vos as boas-vindas. É para mim e para a equipa deste Centro de Juventude do IPDJ um prazer enorme dar-lhes as boas-vindas a este espaço. Acabou de entrar a senhora deputada, doutora Elsa Paes, também a cumprimentar. Esta casa é reconhecida pelo Conselho da Europa como um espaço onde se promovem os direitos humanos, o Estado de Direito e a democracia. São estes os três princípios basilares dessa grande instituição europeia que existe há quase 70 anos e que conta com 47 Estados-membros, todos eles assinantes da Convenção Europeia dos Direitos Humanos, Democracia e Estado de Direito. Sabemos que não tem preço e deve ser permanentemente. E são os direitos humanos que estão em causa na reflexão e discussão do tema que hoje nos traz aqui. Falar de direitos humanos é falar de vida, de existência digna para todas e todos. A dignidade humana de todas e todos sabemos que não tem preço e deve ser permanentemente assegurada, garantida, respeitada. Por e para todas e todos, por e para cada uma e cada um de nós. A integridade moral e física das pessoas é inviolável. Refere a Constituição da República Portuguesa, que dedica na sua parte 1 aos direitos humanos, aos direitos e deveres fundamentais e consagra 24 artigos aos direitos, liberdades e garantias pessoais. Encontramos também na Constituição um artigo que no Instituto Português do Desporto e da Juventude consideramos fundamental, o artigo 70º da Constituição da República. Como sabem, este Instituto tem por missão a execução de uma política integrada e descentralizada para as áreas do desporto e da juventude. Propondo-se dinamizar o apoio ao associativismo, ao voluntariado e promoção da cidadania, à ocupação de tempos livres, à educação não formal, à informação e à mobilidade geográfica dos jovens em Portugal e no estrangeiro. Ora, o artigo 70º da Constituição da República refere os direitos dos jovens que pretendemos amplamente divulgar. Nomeadamente através de ações de sensibilização entre pares, de jovens para e com jovens, nos mais variados espaços onde estes se encontram, mas privilegiando a escola. A educação é para nós a chave. Educar para os direitos humanos, educar para a consciencialização dos valores, da cidadania. E fazê-lo através da participação dos jovens em ações de voluntariado, como o Namorar com Fair Play, através de ferramentas adquiridas no âmbito do programa Empreende Já, que promove a empregabilidade, através do apoio ao associativismo juvenil, essa outra grande escola de participação e de educação não formal. Poderia enumerar aqui cada uma das áreas de intervenção que trabalhamos no Instituto Português do Desporto e Juventude, mas ficam estas como exemplo, desafiando-vos a que nos procurem para saber mais e participar. É claro que trabalhamos em rede, temos parcerias, associamos-nos a iniciativas e é com muita honra que desde 2015 e recentemente renovado por mais 5 anos, o Conselho da Europa nos distingue com um selo de qualidade, mas é também uma grande responsabilidade. Falar, trabalhar os direitos humanos é cada vez mais fundamental. Requer que mantenhamos um foco permanente na instituição europeia que existe há quase 70 anos e que conta com 47 Estados-membros, todos eles assinantes da Convenção Europeia dos Direitos Humanos, Democracia e Estado de Direito. Sabemos que não tem preço e deve ser permanentemente e são os direitos humanos que estão em causa na reflexão e discussão do tema que hoje nos traz aqui. Falar de direitos humanos é falar de vida, de existência digna para todas e todos. A dignidade humana de todas e todos sabemos que não tem preço e deve ser permanentemente assegurada, garantida, respeitada por e para todas e todos, por e para cada uma e cada um de nós. A integridade moral e física das pessoas é inviolável. Refere a Constituição da República Portuguesa, que dedica na sua parte 1 aos direitos humanos, aos direitos e deveres fundamentais e consagra 24 artigos aos direitos, liberdades e garantias pessoais. Encontramos também na Constituição um artigo que no Instituto Português do Desporto e da Juventude consideramos fundamental, o artigo 70º da Constituição da República. Como sabem, este Instituto tem por missão a execução de uma política integrada e descentralizada para as áreas do desporto e da juventude. Propondo-se dinamizar o apoio ao associativismo, ao voluntariado e promoção da cidadania, à ocupação de tempos livres, à educação não formal, à informação e à mobilidade geográfica dos jovens em Portugal e no estrangeiro. Ora, o artigo 70º da Constituição da República refere os direitos dos jovens que pretendemos amplamente divulgar, nomeadamente através de ações de sensibilização entre pares, de jovens para e com jovens, nos mais variados espaços onde estes se encontram, mas privilegiando a escola. A educação é para nós a chave. Educar para os direitos humanos, educar para a consciencialização dos valores, da cidadania, e fazê-lo através da participação dos jovens em ações de voluntariado, como o Namorar com Fair Play, através de ferramentas adquiridas no âmbito do programa Empreende Já, que promove a empregabilidade, através do apoio ao associativismo juvenil, essa outra grande escola de participação e de educação não formal. Poderia enumerar aqui cada uma das áreas de intervenção que trabalhamos no Instituto Português do Desporto e Juventude, mas ficam estas como exemplo, desafiando-vos a que nos procurem para saber mais e participar. É claro que trabalhamos em rede, temos parcerias, associamos-nos a iniciativas e é com muita honra que desde 2015 e recentemente renovado por mais 5 anos, o Conselho da Europa nos distingue com um selo de qualidade, mas é também uma grande responsabilidade. Falar, trabalhar os direitos humanos é cada vez mais fundamental. Requer que mantenhamos um foco permanente, contribuir para uma política pública que vise a proteção das mulheres e raparigas e a prevenção e supressão da sua exploração sexual, nomeadamente através da disponibilização de programas públicos de apoio à saída do comércio sexual, estão de acordo com a missão e visão deste centro, ser um espaço laboratorial de discussão, de partilha de experiências e de opiniões esclarecidas. Queremos que este seja um espaço de referência no trabalho com e para jovens. Dar voz a voz é o que aqui procuramos e queremos que assim aconteça. O Centro de Juventude de Lisboa é também vosso. Proponham. Façam deste espaço um laboratório, um espaço de trabalho. Queremos também crescer junto convosco. Levantemos juntos a bandeira europeia, símbolo de partilha e de união, de aceitação da diversidade, que seja um símbolo da nossa firme convicção em combater quaisquer formas de discriminação e da nossa firme atitude em prol da promoção da vida, da dignidade e dos direitos humanos. O Instituto Português do Desporto e da Juventude e o Centro de Juventude de Lisboa agradecem a escolha deste local para a realização desta conferência, pois este é um espaço de inclusão, reflexão e implementação de atividade que busquem a dignificação da pessoa humana. Somos uma porta aberta para a Europa e para o futuro. Futuro que tem de passar obrigatoriamente por uma sociedade onde as violências que a prostituição encerra não sejam a norma, mas sim a exceção. Para concluir, faço votos de um excelente dia de trabalho produtivo e enriquecedor. A todos, muito obrigada e bem-ajam.
Ora, muito bom dia. Eu sou Alexandra Silva, da Plataforma Portuguesa para os Direitos das Mulheres. Cara Eduarda Marques, diretora regional do Centro de Juventude de Lisboa, a casa que aqui nos acolhe e que muito agradecemos. Cara Ana Sofia Fernandes, vice-presidente do Lobby Europeu das Mulheres, é amiga e companheira de muitas conquistas em matéria de direitos humanos aqui em Portugal e não só. Cara Rachel Moran, mulher que nos inspira e que nos motiva a continuar a luta. Caras e caros participantes, sejam todos e todas muito bem-vindas à Conferência Internacional Exit Sistema da Prostituição. É com grande entusiasmo e elevada expectativa que damos início a esta conferência, que é uma conferência promovida pela Plataforma Portuguesa para os Direitos das Mulheres e pelo Lobby Europeu das Mulheres. A Plataforma Portuguesa é a única plataforma em Portugal que representa organizações promotoras dos direitos humanos das mulheres e da igualdade entre mulheres e homens e que no momento reúne cerca de 26 organizações. Em 2018, nós, feministas e representantes de ONGs de direitos das mulheres, não podíamos deixar que a sociedade patriarcal em que ainda vivemos mantivesse, ou pior ainda, reforçasse a dominação machista ou masculina contra as mulheres na forma da violência e do abuso machista que se configura no sistema da prostituição. Estamos num momento que em Portugal, como em várias partes do mundo, se debate o sistema da prostituição como se debatesse um outro sistema qualquer produtivo, e isto entre aspas, onde muitos entendem que se deve considerar a prostituição como um trabalho, esquecendo o que o sistema da prostituição incorpora. Nós, na Plataforma Portuguesa para os Direitos das Mulheres, partimos da premissa óbvia de que todas as pessoas exploradas no sistema da prostituição, em particular as mulheres e as raparigas, são sujeitas de direitos humanos e não devem ser deixadas para trás, seja pelo Estado, seja pela sociedade, seja pelas organizações políticas, pelas organizações sindicais, pelas associações de juventude, pelas organizações não governamentais e, em particular, por aquelas que defendem os direitos humanos das mulheres. O que é que nós temos feito para que a sociedade não esqueça estas mulheres? Temos procurado contribuir para o desenho de políticas públicas que partem do princípio de que o sistema de prostituição é uma das formas mais gravosas de violência machista contra as mulheres, apresentando, claro, propostas com a necessidade de se avançar para o desenho e implementação de uma política integrada para mulheres e raparigas que queiram deixar a prostituição, programas de saída que tenham impacto concreto e real nas condições de vida das mulheres. Queremos também o reforço da criminalização do lunocínio e a efetiva aplicação do artigo 169 do Código Penal, aquele que respeita ao lunocínio. O reforço da ação do Estado na prevenção e no combate ao tráfico de seres humanos, a criminalização de quem compra sexo, abusa e explora sexualmente, sobrepondo a sua vivência sexual de todas as formas e indiscriminadamente sobre todas as pessoas, e o fim óbvio da violência machista contra as mulheres. Também temos centrado, e isto é o nosso trabalho, temos centrado o debate naquilo que é primordial, nas mulheres exploradas no sistema da prostituição, nos condicionalismos vários que levaram as mulheres a entrar neste sistema, na violência sexual, na pobreza, na ausência das condições de vida digna, na violência e na exploração sexual dos homens pelas mulheres, das mulheres pelos homens. Por último, temos apostado na informação, trazendo ao debate público em Portugal, em várias zonas do país, informação sobre o impacto dos modelos regulamentarista e abolicionista nas condições de vida das mulheres no sistema da prostituição, de que esta conferência é disso exemplo. Hoje, para nós, é um dia muito particular. Temos connosco três sobreviventes do sistema da prostituição. Mulheres que, tendo experienciado todas as dificuldades e a violência presente no sistema, são hoje ativistas que lutam por sociedades justas e igualitárias, fazendo ecoar as vozes das mulheres sobreviventes. Hoje é também um dia de partilha, de reflexão e debate em torno das políticas dos vários Estados-membros da União Europeia em matéria de prevenção e combate à violência contra as mulheres, nomeadamente no sistema da prostituição, que é o nosso primeiro painel, sobre o que pensa e quer a juventude para o futuro que é seu e que deve ser vivido em igualdade entre raparigas e rapazes, mulheres e homens, o nosso segundo painel, em quem muda a sociedade com a sua ação e reflexão em prol dos direitos humanos das mulheres e das raparigas, o terceiro painel, no papel essencial que as políticas e as autoridades locais têm ou podem ter, e é aqui o nosso reforço particular para a Câmara de Lisboa, ou podem ter no apoio às mulheres para a saída do sistema da prostituição, o quarto painel, rematando com considerações finais e conclusões e finalizando com uma peça de teatro. A todos e a todas as oradoras, a Plataforma Portuguesa para os Direitos das Mulheres muito agradece a sua intervenção e participação. Sem eles e sem elas, esta conferência seria mais pobre em informação. Transformar o nosso mundo, fortalecer a paz e a liberdade universais, designadamente através do empoderamento das mulheres e das raparigas, em todos os lugares, e garantir uma vida livre de todas as formas de violência machista contra as mulheres, são requisitos indispensáveis ao desenvolvimento e ao progresso humano justo, democrático e sustentável. Não deixar ninguém para trás será sempre o nosso mote. Note que se aplica com particular ênfase em matéria da promoção dos direitos humanos das mulheres em situação de particular vulnerabilidade, como as mulheres no sistema da prostituição. A todas as pessoas presentes nesta sala, o nosso agradecimento e votos de uma excelente conferência. Obrigada.
Bom dia a todas as pessoas presentes, a cara deputada Elsa Paes, tudo bem, a doutora Eduarda Marques, a Alexandra Silva, a Rachel, que tive o prazer de conhecer há 2 anos, acho eu, nas Nações Unidas, todas as pessoas que estão aqui de vários organismos da administração pública, de associações juvenis, de migrantes, aliadas e aliados feministas. Eu estou aqui na qualidade de vice-presidente do Lobby Europeu das Mulheres, é a maior plataforma de associações de mulheres da União Europeia, somos mais de 2 mil, todos os países membros e dos países da adesão também. E nós este ano, o ano 2018 é um ano particular, porque efetivamente assinalamos este ano 20 anos de uma posição clara no sentido do abolicionismo. Portanto, o movimento de mulheres a nível europeu tem vindo a fortalecer esta posição em face dos vários estudos e da evidência que tem vindo a sair a público e que demonstram como a violência, o sexismo e o racismo são inerentes ao próprio sistema da prostituição. E, portanto, temos feito um trabalho incansável para acabar com esta exploração e, pensando nestes 20 anos e olhando um pouco para trás, para aqueles que foram momentos-chave, há alguns que, neste momento, nos dão algumas oportunidades a potenciar neste contexto e designadamente o facto de termos um Parlamento Europeu que claramente concorda que a prostituição é prejudicial e apoia responsabilizar tanto exploradores como abusadores e também o facto de cada vez mais Estados-membros da União Europeia terem vindo a adotar o chamado modelo da igualdade, ou modelo nórdico, o modelo abolicionista. Portanto, há um momentum, há um contínuo, há uma dinâmica neste momento, e portanto nós achamos também que temos que trabalhar no sentido da sua continuidade. Este é um ano também em que o Lobby Europeu das Mulheres resolveu criar uma task force sobre saúde e direitos sexuais e reprodutivos e exploração sexual. E é uma task force que reúne especialistas de toda a União Europeia para informar a nossa visão feminista sobre estas matérias. Tratamos questões como direitos sexuais e reprodutivos, educação sexual, prostituição, pornografia e gestação de substituição, entre outras. E isto para aumentar a nossa intervenção a este nível em termos europeus. E este é um grupo, esta task force surge na sequência de vários anos de campanhas de sensibilização e de informação para acabar com a violência sexual, a opressão sexual e a desigualdade entre mulheres e homens, e a partir do reconhecimento de que estas questões estão todas interligadas. Elas estão interligadas e elas têm um impacto na segurança, na dignidade das mulheres e na possibilidade das mulheres viverem uma vida de acordo com as suas aspirações. Há dimensões subjacentes comuns, designadamente entre a prostituição e a pornografia, e nós, enquanto Lobby Europeu das Mulheres, queremos, com esta plataforma interna, ter aqui um conjunto de especialistas que nos ajudem a trabalhar numa visão feminista coletiva sobre estes assuntos. Nós continuamos, enquanto lobby, também extremamente preocupadas com a situação relativa à migração na Europa, com o discurso da segurança, com as menções com a falta de recursos, com o discurso da segurança e com a falta de uma abordagem humanitária, solidária e fundada nos direitos humanos, nomeadamente com aquelas pessoas que estão mais vulneráveis. Nós sabemos que o número de pessoas que estão a chegar à Europa está a diminuir, mas nós sabemos também que há muitas pessoas que estão presas em campos de refugiadas e de refugiados, e que particularmente as raparigas e as mulheres estão a viver situações dramáticas nesses contextos. E nós fizemos um relatório europeu chamado Women's Voices, Vozes de Mulheres, que apelam à existência de uma política que tenha em consideração as necessidades específicas das mulheres e raparigas pelo facto de o serem neste contexto, pois sabemos que muitas delas estão a cair em redes de tráfico para fins de exploração sexual, aliciamento, enfim, acabam na prostituição. Para finalizar, gostaria de dizer também que o Lobby Europeu das Mulheres faz um trabalho de coordenação e de apoio de uma rede de mais de 200 organizações a nível europeu, que fazem parte da chamada Brussels Call, o apelo de Bruxelas, e que tem vindo a fazer um trabalho ao longo dos anos que deu designadamente origem a uma resolução-chave aprovada no Parlamento Europeu há 4 anos, a resolução Honeyball, que foi muito clara, recomendando reconhecendo que a prostituição é uma forma de violência contra as mulheres e recomendando 4 ações-chave neste contexto. Por um lado, reduzir a procura da prostituição através da criminalização do cliente, do comprador de sexo. Por outro lado, combater o tráfico e a exploração sexual. Oferecer estratégias de saída, portanto, programas integrados de saída para as mulheres que querem sair do sistema e não conseguem neste momento. E combater a violência contra as mulheres. Portanto, o Parlamento Europeu foi claro, há 4 anos atrás, para o ano vai-se assinalar o 5º aniversário desta resolução histórica, e nós, enquanto Lobby Europeu das Mulheres, queremos fazer uma grande iniciativa em Bruxelas para que o próximo Parlamento Europeu continue a ter esta questão como fundamental em termos de intervenção no futuro. Como vos disse, nós consideramos a prostituição uma forma de violência contra as mulheres. Trabalhamos nesta área há muitos anos em termos europeus e gostaríamos de ver a União Europeia a ter uma ação mais concertada e mais focada, e gostaríamos muito, e é para isso que estamos a trabalhar, que venha a existir uma diretiva na área da violência contra as mulheres, no âmbito da qual nós achamos fundamental que a prostituição seja incluída. Pronto, eu termino aqui. Muito obrigada. E pronto.
Nós vamos passar agora aqui a ter a intervenção da Rachel Moran. A Rachel é fundadora da Space International, que é uma organização mundial de sobreviventes do sistema de prostituição. A Rachel gostaria mais que fossem colocadas questões do que ela fazer um discurso. E nesse sentido apelávamos a que fizessem todas as questões que gostariam de colocar à Rachel.
Thank you. I start with a question so that we can start the conversation. But Rachel, I'd like because I'm going to speak in the panel about youth, and I would like to hear from you what you think are the relationship between prostitution and youth. If you, what's the relationship between prostitution and youth? If you want to, maybe, I don't know. Because I know you've been having some analysis on that.
That's a good question, thank you. For anybody who didn't hear it, it was what is the relationship between prostitution and youth? I think in recent years, in feminism, we've got more educated around the concept of intersectionality as a result of an important piece of scholarship that came out of the United States. Unfortunately, it's been skewed and twisted and misinterpreted. But the basic concept of intersectionality, I think, is very important. And what I immediately think of when I hear that question is the intersectionality between classism and the vulnerability of youth. I remember in my own adolescence seeing everywhere around me that intersectionality, that combination. Because what we saw on the streets and in the brothels was very, very young women or girls. And, you know, I was 15 when I got into prostitution. And what I saw in the first couple of years was girl after girl after girl coming out on the streets alongside me. And they were either girls I'd known from the residential care system or girls who were friends of girls I'd known from those same hostels. So there was that intersectionality between, we were the lowest of the low, to give in blunt terms, in societal terms. You know, we were all disadvantaged working class, and we were too young to be consenting to any kind of sex, never mind the coercive sex of prostitution. So, you know, when I'm asked about youth, And that is what I think of. I think about the vulnerability. I think about the way that we were positioned in the world and the way those particular vulnerabilities and the combination of the two were abused and exploited. And also the very twisted desire that presents in men who buy sexual access to women and girls to find the youngest of the young. I saw that not only on the streets, but in one sense it was actually more marked when I went indoors, because then you were on the phone and you were talking to men who couldn't see you, so they were asking questions and they were very clear about what they wanted, and they would make that clear in a variety of ways. Very often they would directly ask, what's the youngest girl you've got? Sometimes they were a little more subtle, you know, they'd ask for you to describe the women who were on that day, and you'd say, well, there's this woman, she's 26, that woman, she's 23, this woman, she's 19. And in every case I can remember, I mean, like 99 times out of 100, they would go for the youngest girl. This is without seeing them, you know what I mean? This is without, like, I mean, for all they knew, the 19-year-old could have been 25 stone. It was just the fact that she was 19, that was the draw, that was the pull. So there is, I call it despoilment. I've given a lot of thought to this, and I've spent a lot of time trying to figure out why did they always want the youngest girl. And I think that there is a sexual urge that's about pollution, you know, despoilment. It's about wanting to find the female that's closest to this concept of sexual purity. That's what's going on here, and we can see that all throughout pornography. You know, it's everywhere in the world. And I really feel that we cannot understand what prostitution is until we understand that concept of despoilment. This is very, very, very tough work, let me just say, you know, to sit here or anywhere and talk about the things that we lived, saw, remembered, and deal with every day. It is not easy. And we do this because it is so desperately important. You know, because I honestly believe if we keep on the trajectory that we're on, we're not going to leave behind a world that's worth living in for the generations coming up behind us. We're just not. We've gone too far. We're already over the edge of reality in terms of what is acceptable to human beings. There's the dignity is stripped out of life itself at this point. I'm a mother. I have a son. And I regularly remind myself how lucky I am not to have a daughter, honestly. You know, that I could talk at length about this. You know, when you talk about youth, and I think about, you know, not only the youth of yesterday, the youth that we were, and several of the girls that I stood alongside on the streets are not living anymore. But I think about the youth of today and the youth of tomorrow, and I'm so passionately determined that people just wake up and really take a look at what's going on here, because we are in a dangerous, dangerous place right now in the world. And it's the youth we ought to be thinking of. Thank you for that question.
I wonder how this concept of despoilment it relates to youth health, because I'm interested in youth health since I'm coordinating a Portuguese program on that. So I would like you to develop some ideas about that concept, health and despoilment you talked about.
I think that when I'm working out new ideas, I need to really give it some thought and some time, and I prefer to write them out rather than, you know, trip off the top of my head. But there is an important link there. And I think as far as the health of anybody, I think it starts between the ears. Do you know what I mean? Like if you move through the world, as a young person, and particularly as a young female, what you actually are is a walking target right now. That's where we're at. You're a walking target. I was a walking target as a homeless 14-year-old. I was homeless for over a year before I got into prostitution. So I left my home in the spring of 1990, and I got into prostitution in the summer of the following year. And in that year, my body developed rapidly, very rapidly. When I left home, I was tall, skinny, you know, I was all arms and legs, typical skinny little white girl. And within that 12 or so months, I developed breasts, I developed the backside, I developed hips, I just like grew overnight. And I certainly didn't grow mentally or, you know, psychologically or emotionally in line with my body. Do you know what I mean? I didn't develop anywhere near so quickly as to be able to deal with this onslaught of male attention. And, you know, if I had have been a young girl in school, you know, in a mixed-sex environment, maybe I could have dealt with, you know, the attention from young boys, natural, normal attention. But I was a homeless young girl. So I was being approached relentlessly day to day by grown men old enough to be my father, grandfather in lots of cases. And I couldn't deal with what was presented to me, and shouldn't have had to deal, obviously. But, you know, talking about the link between, you know, youth and health, I just think that people just cannot conceptualize, because I think most women, I've yet to meet a woman who hasn't had an experience she didn't want to have when it came to male sexual attention. But if you have this, you know, once or twice or three times in a lifetime, women will always remember that. They'll remember it 40, 50, 60 years previous. But if you have that day to day to day to day, you come to understand something about the negative twist that exists in human sexuality. And I think that when you understand that from the floor up, you know, when you really get it, it obliges you to examine it publicly. That's my personal feeling on the matter. And I only direct it towards myself, by the way. I'm not saying that, you know, I'm not prescribing anybody else how they live their lives. But I really think that that link between youth and health that you're talking about, there's a hell of a lot more to say here. And I'm sorry if I haven't articulated myself fully, but that's the best stab I can give it at like 10 o'clock in the morning. Thank you.
I really appreciate your testimony. I would like to ask, if you had the girl, how would you change the world so that you wouldn't say that you are lucky to have such a lucky to have a girl as a boy? Do you understand what I mean?
You
said that you had a child, he's a boy, and that you felt lucky that he's a boy and not a girl. How would you change the system so that if you had a girl instead of a boy, you would also say that you are lucky, you would feel happy to have a girl?
I understand your question, and thank you for asking me that, because I think I probably phrased what I was saying clumsily, if anyone didn't understand it. What I meant was that having a boy instead of a girl means that I don't have to worry constantly. I don't have to watch my child and worry every time they walk out the front door. As far as, you know, influence and change in the world, I think all of us who are parents of boys need to school those boys. And you can believe we've had the pornography conversation in my house. We had it quite some time ago and several times. You know, so my attitude towards my son is I tell him that just because there's a proliferation of all of this all around the world doesn't mean that you have any right to be a part of it. You know, this is wrong, it's sick, it's ugly, and I don't care if it's on every street corner on the planet, that does not give you a right to buy into it. And I think that as a parent, that's what we have to do when it comes to influencing our boys. We have to teach them right from wrong, quite simply. Because I think that there's a hell of a lot that's going wrong with the world, and one of those things is that we step away. The sense of personal responsibility or accountability when it comes to influencing your own child seems to be less and less taken seriously now in the world. You know, it's kind of like, it takes a village to raise a child. We seem to believe that all of society is responsible for our own kids. But what goes on in the four walls of my home, that's on me. You know, and I would say that to every parent, because if we all are giving our boys that same message, well, then we're going to have a lot less of this as we continue.
Hi, Rachel. Good morning. Could you please talk a little bit more about space, about your organization? What kind of activities do you do? And also, what are the main obstacles to develop those activities? Besides arguing and fighting, you know, this subject, of course, that you probably share with almost all of us here, but the activities you develop and the obstacles that you find in that work.
Thank you for the question. So we're an organization of women across 10 nations and 4 continents now. All of us have lived the sex trade. We came together initially as an Irish organization, but within 12 months it became very clear that the need to broaden out as an international organization was just, it was paramount. We had to do it. It was so obvious. I sent out the flyers in the autumn of 2011. It was the following spring before women started to come back to me. I had to circulate the flyers a second time. And I was starting to get kind of distressed and upset at that point. It was about 6 months after I'd first reached out. No women had come back to me. And I was thinking, we have to organize politically. We have to get together on this as a political force. because the Turn Off the Red Light campaign had kicked off in Ireland in February of 2011. So it was about 6 months after that that I said, okay, we need a group of Irish women who are willing to put their faces in front of a camera and tell the truth about what prostitution was to us and is on this earth. We have to do it. And naturally, women were reluctant. When they eventually started to come back in the spring of the following year, some would speak on camera, some wouldn't. The women who wouldn't speak on camera, excuse me, they were every bit as useful, actually, as the women who would. And that was one of the lessons that I learned, because women will meet privately with politicians, they'll do all sorts of work behind the scenes, they'll give, you know, anonymous interviews to the media, et cetera, et cetera. And so in that way, we began to organize. And within another 12 months of that, I had begun to travel internationally. So I went to the United States. I saw black women saying exactly the same thing as I was saying, met indigenous Canadian women saying exactly the same thing, and so on and so forth. And then it became apparent really quickly that if we were to put all of those women in a row, that was a very powerful force. Because here we are all over the world with all of our different cultural and ethnic backgrounds all saying the same thing. So that's how we made the shift from Space Ireland to Space International. What we do, much of it, quite honestly, is not known or designed to be known, because we do a lot of work behind the scenes. And if I was to reveal that publicly, well, then, you know, the powers that be would be quite happy to try to block what we do. What we do in public is we put on panels all over the world, you know, at the UN, in the European Parliament, in Westminster, and so on and so forth. And basically what we're about is changing minds. We're an advocacy group. We're about putting the reality of prostitution in front of people, because it's a very, very difficult thing to confront. And I do my best to be patient, and it's hard, let me tell you, you know, because when there are so many people who think that the reality of prostitution is something that you can learn from a textbook, you know, the sociologists, anthropologists, you know, all of these people, they think that they can learn about prostitution in a university. We didn't learn about prostitution in a university. We learned about it on the street corners and in the red light zones and in the brothels and in the graveyards and in the jails. That's where we learned about prostitution. And what makes me, I get incredibly angry sometimes, and I have to calm, stay calm, be calm, you know, and to try to be patient, because the reality is you don't know what you don't know. And there's a lot of well-intentioned people who are coming to this issue from the whole wrong perspective, but they're doing it because they want to make things easier for the women. So they're doing the wrong thing for the right reasons, and I have to remind myself of that constantly. Because there's no point in biting back and being aggressive and being angry. You don't win hearts and minds that way. You don't change anybody's perception in that way. So that's what we try to do. We just tell the truth. We tell our lived reality, not only what we personally experienced, but what we witnessed all around us. And when you put this in front of people, like, for example, over 50% of prostituted people in Canada are drawn from 3% of the population, right? So 6% of Canadians are Indigenous Canadians. Half of that number are Indigenous Canadian females. From that 3%, over 50% of prostitute people are drawn. Now, you can't look at a figure like that and fail to see the blatant racism and exploitation within it. And when you tell people this, when they hear that, then you see the scales fall from their eyes. So that's what Space International is all about. It's about telling the truth in every kind of arena we can tell it, and trying to draw out some human understanding in order to put an end to this hell that so many women and girls are living.
Hi, Rachel. Thank you so much for being with us. It's especially for me very important to hear someone that was in the system. So thank you very much. We understand, as survivors of other kinds of violence, how difficult it is to be there. So thank you very much. I would like to hear from you what is necessary for women that need to, that want to exit the system, what really needs to be done. Okay, if you could share with us from your experience. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the question, and thank you as well for identifying it as a system, because that's exactly what it is, and that's what I want people to really understand. People refer to prostitution as an industry, okay? So, you know, there's a commercial element to it, of course. That's why it, that's what keeps the wheels turning from one particular aspect, but much more than an industry, it is a system, it is an institution, you know? As far as what's necessary for women to get out, well, we advocate exit strategies as one element of the way to deal with this. So what we promote what's known as the Nordic model or the abolitionist model. As it moves around the world, it's picking up all sorts of different names. I personally don't much care what it's called as long as we pass it. It has three basic elements to it. It's the criminalization of exploiters, be they sexual or financial. So your punters, as we say in Ireland, the Johns, they say in the United States. I don't know what the local terminology here is in Portugal. But anybody who's exploitative within that system, they get criminalized. Anybody who's exploited within that system, they get decriminalized. And exit strategies is the third leg to that stool. So there's various elements within the exit strategies that we promote. What I would say is that there has to be a multiplicity of exit services, because when I look across even just the timeline in my own life, the 7 years I was in prostitution, I got out when I was 22. Now, when I was 15, I got in the first place because I was homeless. So at that point in my life, I would have needed help with housing, of course. A couple of years into that, I was a mother. I would have needed help with childcare. Another year or two, I was a raging narcotic addict. I would have needed addiction services. So it's not only about what an individual woman needs, but it's also about the timeline of her life. So if you have a center where women can go to, and let me just interrupt myself to say, had there been such a center in Dublin in the 90s that I was aware of, I would have been in that door so fast it would have made the punter's head spin. I would have been gone off that street like a rocket. And what I would have needed would have been some kind of hope. I think more than anything, I would have needed hope. I would have needed the hope for a future. You know, I would have needed education, training. Had anybody said to me, Rachel, we can teach you how to type, we can teach you how to work a computer. I was 24 years of age before I turned on a computer. You know, my whole adolescence and early 20s was just wiped right out. And it was a flat miracle that I was able to come back from that. And because I had no support whatsoever. So what I'm saying is that we need to give women an array of support. Wherever, there's nobody on this planet is gonna tell you what a woman needs better than that woman herself. So we need to have a situation where a woman can walk in to a center, say, here's where I'm at, here's what I need right now, here's what I want for the future, can you help me? And that what she needs is a yes, yes, and yes again. And of course, by the way, when I'm talking about women, I'm talking about anybody in prostitution. I talk about women because women make up the vast, vast, vast majority. But I don't ignore, of course, the fact that there's men and boys and trans persons. Anybody who's exploited within that system needs and deserves help to get out of it. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I would like to share something really quickly because I just read a news from today that a court in Portugal decided that a young woman in a discotheque was raped by two guys, and the court decided that it wasn't harmful enough for them to be in jail. So I'm kind of shocked with it. And I started thinking, and there's a general idea that women in certain circumstances are asking for it. That's what was in the sentence. Like when they are drunk, when they wear some type of clothes, or when they are on the streets because of prostitution. So I would like to know your opinion about how can we change this perception of women, and what can we do to help like this cultural idea to change?
The first memory that comes to my mind when I hear what you've just said is the time that I walked into a police station at 16 years of age. I'd been in prostitution about a year, and I'd been slapped around that night. Not particularly hard, not worse than any other night, you know, that I'd experienced that. But that night, it just pissed me off. I just had enough. I was thinking, why, you know, the fact that I'm here in this situation, you're buying me, you're using me, doesn't give you the right to hit me. So I went into the police station anyway, and I tried to make a report. And the young male officer on the other side of the desk, he was only about 23 or 4, he just simply laughed at me. He burst out laughing. Now, you know, with the kind of the perspective of years gone by, I tried to see that from the other side of the desk. You know what I mean? What was so humorous to him? I mean, the thing that was so painful to me was that it's strange. Sometimes when a person is not trying to be cruel, that's the cruelest they can ever be. Because he wasn't trying to communicate any form of nastiness. It was just to him, a space alien may as well have walked into that police station and tried to report violence. In his conceptual reality, a woman in prostitution had absolutely no business trying to file a report in the first place. So to answer your question, there's a major societal shift that needs to happen. This young man simply didn't believe. I mean, I may as well have walked in there on me hands, you know what I mean? It was just like, I was like something out of a carnival to him. There was no bridge, no link that he could bridge between what he was perceiving with his eyes and what he was hearing with his ears. It was crazy to him. And I think back now, looking at that, you know, what it was to me to feel that way, to be so dismissed, you know. I never walked into a police station again as a result of prostitution, ever. And I certainly needed to walk into police stations in the aftermath a hell of a lot more than I did that night. But that broke any link of trust that could ever have existed between me and the police force in Ireland. So I suppose to answer your question in a nutshell, there's so much we need to change. But I do not believe we're ever going to get there as long as sexual violence is entertainment, because that's what it is. There's billions of euros being generated every day online through pornography. I know one young woman, and this is just one example. I won't go too deeply into detail because it was her experience and not mine. But she was horribly, horribly assaulted in a life-changing manner one night. And when she related her experience to another woman, she was told, oh, well, that's up all over porn. I mean, that's one of the hottest things you can see in porn. So she went on to one of the porn sites, and it was the first scene that popped up. So you see, women are living the reality of what men are jacking off to online. Our violation is entertainment at this point, and it has been for decades. And now that we're in the situation where we have the internet and these images and horror scenes are communicated with this rapidity that we couldn't have imagined 30 years ago, we really are, and I cannot overstate this, in a very, very, very dangerous place. And the answer to your question, how do we find our way back? I don't know. That's the truth. I don't know. But I do know we'll never find our way back until we acknowledge what's happening. And so many of us are not willing to acknowledge it. So at the very least, we need to start there.
Hi. My English is not the best, so I'll try to do my best, okay? As an activist, I always say, I see all the time on feminism, on social movement, they are talking about prostitution in an abstract way. Like, they are talking about something they don't live, they have never been close to, but they are thinking as if they were reading a book. But sometimes I feel like women, especially women, are talking about prostitution this way because they don't have contact to this reality and they don't have information about it. So as an activist, again, it's hard to me to imagine a feminist movement who doesn't take prostitution as a baseline to women politics and women survival and to talk about male domination. So I would like to ask you, what do you think the women in the feminist movement could do, to reach prostituted women to talk about prostitution? Because I feel they don't do nothing, and they don't know how to talk about prostitution, what to do about prostitution. And I'm talking about politics here, not debates, not events. I'm talking about asking for politics and what they could do to get closer to this reality, to help women in prostitution as a feminist movement. What do you think about it?
That's a really good question, and there's at least a half a dozen different ways of answering it, so I'm going to try and kind of tease through some of them. In a nutshell, they need to pass the Nordic model. It's that simple. You could wrap it up in that space of that one sentence. Pass the Nordic model, boom, there's your answer, right? But it's more complex than that. You see, the problem with prostitution is that it's too big. It's too big to perceive, right? I mean, it's only now, at the distance of many years, that I can look back. You see, when you're living inside something, you have that unique view, right? And then when years pass, you can look back and you can perceive it having lived it, but you also have the tool of distance, right? So you can perceive it in a way that's conceptually more clarified than it would have been when you were right in it. Kind of like being in, you know, a furnace. And I think that the problem is when there's so many young, trying to answer your question, it's difficult to answer a question like that without swearing and getting vulgar, right? Because I kind of feel like I wish I was on a bar stool right now, because then I could really give it to you straight, you know what I mean? It makes me so angry when I listen to these young women. They're like 20, 25, the ink is not yet dry on their college degree, and they're trying to tell me what prostitution is. Right, and they've got the bald, ignorant nerve to frame it as sex work. Prostitution is neither sex nor work, so let's start there, right? I mean, these women haven't got a clue, but I'll tell you what they do know. They don't get it on an intellectual level, but they damn well get it on a sensory level, because they do not want to go in and do a shift in a brothel themselves and then come back to me. So whatever it is that they think they know, their body knows, right? And that's the split, that's the shift. It's about understanding prostitution fully is not possible without bringing all of the elements of a human being into it. You have to understand it on a sensory level. You have to know what it is to be touched when you don't want to be touched, but you have to keep your mouth shut because you're taking that money, and what you're really dealing with at that level is the commercialization of sexual abuse. And it's so painful and difficult on so many levels, because you are culpable. As an individual, you are culpable in your own violation, and that's another layer of guilt and shame. It's, you know, I think prostitution is not only sexual abuse, it's the ugliest, slyest, most covert form of sexual abuse on this planet. And that's what these young women just do not understand, at least on an intellectual level. But their body knows it, and I would say that to any woman.
Hi, Rachel. Thank you for being here. And I'm Brazilian, and my English is also not the best, but I will try. I would like to know what you think about the prostitutes that go into movements pro-prostitution and pro-legalization, because now there is a fight inside feminism about this issue. And a lot of called prostitutes and prostitutes themselves go and fight for the model of legalization. And in Brazil, we have a model proposed that gives 50% of the money to a pimp, and prostitutes fight for that. And the part of feminism that is pro-prostitution, they they use these voices of prostituted women to how can I say?
To push their agenda. Is that what you mean?
What?
To push their agenda.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
What do you think about why there are prostituted women who claim for that model of legalization and the institutionalization of this model? Thank you.
This afternoon, we're going to hear from my colleague in Space International, Sabrina Valise, who actually was on the other side of that political fence, so she'll be able to give you a first-hand answer to that question. But I know that had things shaken down differently, had the Turn Off the Red Light campaign come along in the 90s when I was in prostitution, it would have frightened the hell out of me, because it would have been a direct challenge to where I was positioned in the world. And I felt like I didn't have any other options. Nobody was offering me any other options. So, you know, had somebody come along and said, okay, we're going to criminalize the men from whom you earn your living, that would have been a direct threat to how I was to exist in the world. So you couldn't have come along and offered, you had to offer a solution. You couldn't come along and create a situation within which I could not maneuver, if you know what I mean. So you have to offer women exit services alongside of criminalizing the men who use them. It's absolutely imperative. And I know that from my own, you know, my own history. But, you know, to get back to your question more directly, why do women do this? I sometimes think about who I would have been had circumstances shook down differently. And quite honestly, I think I would have been my own worst nightmare. I would have been an absolute nightmare for the abolitionist movement. But I think bigger, more than that now, I would have been a nightmare for myself. You know what I mean? Because the nightmare would have been in the mirror looking back at me. I would have been so riven with animosity and aggression and resentment, and certainly class-based resentment. I would have been, just to give it to you up straight, incredibly pissed off with middle-class women coming along telling me what was what and who was who in my own reality when I was a disadvantaged working-class homeless girl who had no other options. I would have been spitting nails. I would have been so angry. So you have to understand that, you know, there's a lot of these women and girls, I mean, they're not resentful for no reason. They've bloody good reason to be resentful. You know, and this is why I say we have got to give women other alternatives. And you will find that the vast majority of women, when they're offered alternatives, real, viable solutions, they will take them. And the women in the opposition who are, you know, lining up alongside, you know, the pimps' agenda, it's only because they have no other viable options. You give them options, and I'm telling you, the political opposition would be like a ghost town. It would be all the pimps and punters over there talking for themselves. Listen, we're never going to see a union for pimps, a union for punters. What we see is like the International Union of Sex Workers. It's not a union, and there are no sex workers, right? So it's laughable. What these people do is the pimps just set up their own organizations. They pull the women in alongside them. The women have no room to maneuver. This is the best they've got on offer. So they fall in lockstep with all this nonsense. But it's only because they don't have viable choices. So that's the best I can do to answer that.
Thank you.